Hey guys, it has definitely been more than a few minutes since I recorded the last video. I'm joking. No, I'm not. Red Shoes and an Allmight Wristwatch by Linari. Chapter 2. He had saved enough money to get some good tech, and it was going to change everything. The tiny mic would let Izuku collect real evidence. He set it up that night, just outside the Yakuza base. He wasn't dumb enough to try and sneak in at this point. Considering that, he did need to see what kind of sensors they had. Izuku collected a few articles of litter as he walked by the outside house. He tossed the garbage into the yard. Once he was around the corner, he sprinted away and circled up to the usual spying place on the building across the street. No one emerged from their hideout. Izuku had already scouted the few cameras they had set up. From what he could tell, their field of vision included the front yard and street. He would see a child with a hoodie tossing the trash. Oh, they would see a kid with a hoodie tossing the trash in. But the fact that no one emerged meant they probably didn't have sensors that set off alarms. The beauty of an organization with a bunch of powerful quirks was that they were overconfident in their own safety. He moved slowly on his journey home. The man had obviously wanted the little girl for some kind of purpose. The harsh demand he'd made when she had run into Izuku and clung to him. Izuku had to stop briefly to take a deep breath when he remembered the feeling of rough bandages, unwashed hair against his cheek, and trembling, frail limbs. He jumped to the next roof, landing in a neat roll. Well, surprise, surprise. Izuku yelped as he entangled for a second time in a razor capture weapon. He snarled, pulling out his knife and trying to cut the strap, but it didn't give way under his blade. Had he forgotten to sharpen his knife? "It's not a cloth," Eraserhead said dryly. Izuku perked up at that. "Oh, is it some kind of alloy or carbon fiber? It must be some kind of combination, or it wouldn't bend properly and be able to guide at the same time. That makes sense." Fuck.
"It doesn't matter to you, kid. You're coming with me." Izuku dug his heels into the hero tugged a bit. "On what grounds?" "Well, to start vigilantism. It's illegal." "On what grounds?" he repeated. Eraserhead rolled his eyes. "Kid, we were both there that last night, and know what you did, as do the security cameras."
"Vigilantism is defined as using a quirk inappropriately to pursue a hero work without license." "I didn't use my quirk. "Oh, my quirk. Izuku folded his arms. "You're talking to me without... You're taking me in with no reason." The hero stopped pulling on his capture inside. "You're really going to make this more difficult than it needs to be, huh?" "I'll sue you for holding me against my will." Eraserhead dropped the loops of his capture weapon and allowed him to take a step back.
I died.
Is there... Eraser had dropped the loops of his capture weapon and allowed him to take a step back. Is there anything I can do to convince you to be a normal kid and not run across rooftops in the middle of the night? Normal kid? Quirkless kids were the opposite of normal. Izuku shook his head. Just let me do my thing, Eraserhead. I'm not your responsibility. A minor putting themselves in harm's way is my responsibility. He groaned. Please pretend you never saw me. I promise I don't want your help. You may not want it, but are you sure you don't need it? Izuku considered the man. Eraserhead tried to be an underground hero most of the time, wanting to stay out of the spotlight for more discreet work. Maybe he could use him as a contact point between him and the police. I'm looking into something, he said slowly. I don't have any substantial evidence, anything substantial yet. But once I obtain evidence, I can let you know. Eraserhead's eyes narrowed at him. What kind of something? Izuku shook his head. I'll let you know. How will I find out? How will I find you? Izuku smirked under his mask. You've found me twice so far. The city isn't that big. He ran away. He ran before Eraserhead could come up with another excuse to detain him. He had seen the man reach into his pocket, possibly calling the police, who could legitimately hold him for trespassing on rooftops. Not that he was going to remind Eraserhead of that. The next day was Saturday, which let Izuku sleep off the exhaustion of the night patrol. He was woken up around noon by his mom's gentle back rub. I don't know why you need so much sleep, child, she murmured. Maybe it means I'm growing, Izuku said hopefully. He hated how short he still was. If he got a growth spurt, maybe people would stop thinking of he was a kid on patrols. His mom kissed the top of his head. They're showing reruns of the sports festival. I know how bummed you were that you missed it the first time. Izuku nodded. He didn't necessarily want to watch it. A lot of his enthusiasm for UA had waned after his rejection. But he did need to gather intel on the up-and-coming hero's quirks. Out in the living room, he could hear President Mike's excited commentary. Obstacle course. Izuku wandered out and froze as the first image he saw was Kachan blasting ahead of the crowd with his power. He rubbed his chest absently. The place where the last burn he'd gotten from the guy before they had gone their separate ways. Of course, Kachan would be the best of the lot. He watched the rest of the trials, analyzing. Lots of strong quirks. One kid was supposedly half ice, half fire, but seemed to only use his ice. Maybe saving up for a surprise attack? He had been announced as Endeavor's son. Once they got into individual matches, things got more interesting. Izuku absently ate the rice and pork that his mom had prepared for him. There was a purple-haired kid who seemed to just command someone else to walk out of the ring. He couldn't quite tell what made the kid do that, since they didn't have mics on the kids. His quirk had to be an interesting one. No contact. If he only had to speak to control someone, he would be incredibly powerful. Izuku jumped as the camera focused on a small girl with short brown hair, Yuraka, of all people. She was going up against Kachan. Izuku braced himself and then stared in shock as the girl kept attacking. Her quirk, present mic, had to do with controlling gravity, and every time Kachan blasted a bit of the arena, he watched her touch the debris and send it up without Kachan noticing. Izuku could suddenly picture her reaching out that night and sending him up to space. Him trailing her to make sure she stayed safe seemed pretty dumb now. She could obviously take care of herself. Despite her vicious attack, Kachan managed to blast away the debris when she sent it crashing down on top of him. Izuku sighed. It was a genius attempt, but Kachan's quirk was too powerful. The purple-haired boy went up against half-ice, half-fire kid. Izuku waited eagerly for some sign of how the kid mind-controlled, but despite the kid appearing to be spitting insults at the ice-fire kid, it didn't seem to work. The ice-fire kid froze with him without a problem. He sat back. It couldn't just be as simple as looking at the person to gain control. It probably had a weakness that the ice fire kid had figured out. How's it looking? Izuku's mom had been doing some cleaning, but kept popping her head in. Oh look, it's little Katsuki. Not so little anymore, Izuku murmured. He watched as he easily defeated some kid with a shadow quirk. Weakness to light. That was unfortunate. The final fight was pure action. Izuku watched with a mixture of jealousy and admiration as the ice met fire again and again. The colder Kachan got, the weaker his blasts were. But it also seemed like the ice fire kid was getting sluggish with the cold as well. Izuku didn't understand why he wasn't using his fire to heat himself up. Despite his sluggishness, the kid managed to catch Kachan's foot with ice and send him flying. He went out of the arena, and that was it. It should have felt satisfying seeing Kachan get taken down a peg, but Izuku had always admired Kachan's strength. Wanted to see him succeed and be the greatest hero, and be one alongside him. He turned off the TV. "Don't you want to watch the second and third years?" his mom asked. He shook his head. "I'm gonna go for a run." His mother's sad green eyes followed him out of the apartment. Izuku waited until he was far enough away before he started sprinting. He made it to Takaba. I don't know how to say that word. I apologize. Takoba Beach. And found him gasping, hands on his knees. He bit back tears. After getting rejected from UA, he had sworn to himself he would stop crying so much. If he was going to be a waste of space in the world, he may as well not be fill up that space with tears. Izuku took stock of the beach and found a stack of what looked like car parts. He carted piece after piece from the beach to the dumpster. The city employee he was working with was staying true to his word and having the dumpster regularly emptied. By late afternoon, Izuku had sweated through his shirt. He threw one last load into the dumpster and walked down the beach. "Trash among trash," he muttered to himself and giggled a little. A violent cough nearby gave Izuku a heart attack. He whirled, finding a tall, scrawny blonde man hacking into one hand. It looked like blood. "Sir," he rushed over, pulling out his phone. "Are you all right? I'm calling emergency services now." The man held up his hand. "No, no. It's fine. It's a chronic problem." He stared at the blood on his hands. "Sir, that doesn't seem like a chronic problem." The man smiled a little. Blood standing his teeth. "Never fear, young man." Izuku took a deep breath. "If you're sure." "What are you doing here?" Taking a step back, Izuku crossed his arms. "It's a public beach," he said defensively. The man cocked his head at him. "No, not like that. You're cleaning it?" "I didn't think the city was going to do that." "I'm not working for the city." He shifted uncomfortably from foot to foot. I saw the beach was like this and, well, it's a good workout, you know? That's awfully responsible of you, young man." Izuku felt the corner of his mouth tilt up. He'd have to get this guy to vouch for him to erase her head. "Do you need help getting home?" he asked politely. "No, my boy. I'll be fine. What's your name?" He tried to think of a reason to avoid giving it, but the guy looked harmless enough. "Midoriya Izuku." "I'm Yagi Toshinori." The man smiled at him. The smile felt strangely familiar, and Izuku felt warm, though he wasn't sure why. "Good to meet you." He glanced at his Allmight watch. "I do need to get home, sir. Are you sure you'll be okay?" "I'll be fine, young Midoriya." Izuku bowed and then darted off, shoving his gloves back into his pocket. He was planning on getting home to help his mom make dinner before his usual patrol. Weekends were a prime time for villains to strike. Usually he didn't work out beforehand because he didn't want to exert himself. But after watching people live out his dream on TV, well, it had been worth it for the distraction. Izuku was in hot pursuit of a guy who had been in the midst of assaulting a woman outside a bar. The man had the ability to create a brief wall of smoke. It made it difficult to track him when the guy would dart down the alleyways or even spin around and send Izuku back, twisting to catch up. Still, the guy didn't have the endurance Izuku had. He finally managed to snag his sleeve with a strong yank, swinging the guy back and sending him to the ground. "That was fun," he panted. He quickly tied the guy's hands and feet together. "Let me go, you have no proof." He waved his phone at the guy. "I think the police will beg to differ when they see this footage, hmm?" He snarled, releasing another plume of smoke from his nose. "Is it hot?" Izuku asked. "When you create that hot steam stuff, do you get dehydrated?" The guy's response was rather rude. Izuku rolled his eyes, knocked the guy out, and picked him up in a fireman's carry. The chatter of friendly young voices was approaching from around the street corner. Izuku ducked his head and kept walking. There was nowhere to run around here on the open street. He had somehow ended up near the UA campus. If he was lucky, the kids would assume he was a hero. "Whoa, dude, what do you think you're doing?" Izuku was never lucky. He turned, analyzing the group in front of him. 4 total, Kachan among them. He wanted to scream at how unfair it all was. "Let that man go," the one with spiky red hair looked at him like he was a villain. He did something to his arms that make him look like pieces of skin-colored wood. A hardening quirk. Kirishima, we can't use our quirks to fight. We need to call a teacher, Ribbit. Izuku tried to think of a way to declare that he was doing without talking. Kachan would recognize his voice. "Let's just smash the snowbody and then call the cops," Kachan growled. His hands began popping. Izuku could still remember how that felt and tried not to cringe back. "Here," he said, making his voice sound hoarse. This man was trying to rape a woman. He held out his phone. The girl, who probably had a frog quirk given her hands and feet, took Izuku's phone with her long tongue. "He's telling the truth."
"Are you a hero?" the blonde one grinned at him. "That's so cool. I don't recognize you."
Izuku shrugged, taking his phone back and hefting the guy higher. He kept his eyes on Kachan, expecting him to make some kind of violent move. He didn't do anything. "If you're a hero, then why are you wearing a mask?" the red one, Kirishima, asked.
"Bad acne," Izuku muttered.
He got a loud laugh from the blonde one and Kirishima. Kachan didn't look convinced. He needed to hurry. "Look, if you want, take him up to the police yourself, but he's getting heavy, and I need to go."
Izuku bit his lip as some of his old stutter slipped in. Being around Kachan was stressful.
"Whatever, let's go." Kachan turned. Izuku sighed in relief. "I think your mask is cool, dude." The blonde one gave him a double thumbs up as the group began walking away.
"Thanks,"
he whispered. He found himself staring longingly as they rounded another corner and disappeared from sight. In another life, pretty soon, he'd be scrambling to keep up with those guys. Izuku felt the thug on his back begin to stir. He had a long way to go yet, and the sun was setting. "Lift your feet facing forwards." Izuku made a face. "That feels wrong."
"It feels wrong because you've been doing it incorrectly before," Yagi coughed a little, waving off.
Izuku's concerned glance. "Try feeling the other muscles." Izuku nodded. The stack of broken chairs he was lifting wobbled a bit, but he managed to keep them balanced.
"How do you know so much about proper lifting?" Izuku
Cat! Holy hell!
"Juniper, you can't sneak up on me like that."
Mean little baby. Yagi grinned. "I wasn't always like this." He tossed them into the dumpster, vaguely proud. He was pretty sure those were heavier than what he used to lift.
"Hey, kid, you're bleeding."
"What?" Izuku looked down to see one of the chair legs must have caught his arm. He poked at it disinterestedly with his glove.
"It's not deep, Yagi, don't worry."
"Deep or not, you always need to clean a wound correctly." Yagi came over and took Izuku's arm himself. "Do you have any supplies?" Izuku shook his head. He had a pack he took with him on patrols, which was well used, but Yagi didn't need to know that.
"Well, I think I have something in my truck."
Izuku watched him walk away. He didn't make sense that a guy like Yagi kept coming along to help him. After their initial encounter, he kept running into him on the beach until they seemed to strike up some unspoken deal, where Yagi would give Izuku tips on training. He had even mentioned a few of the combat techniques that he knew when Izuku had talked about wanting to learn at the gym. The man came back, coughing into his elbow. "Why do you waste your time on me?" he asked. He bit his lip after he said it. Yagi's intense eyes caught Izuku's and he couldn't look away, even if he wanted to. Why would it be a waste of time? You obviously have experience. You should be training people who actually can be heroes. I know a fierce spirit when I see one. Yagi washed the wound with disinfectant, and Izuku hissed through his teeth. Why don't you let me decide what's a waste of time, okay?
That is the end of chapter 2 of Red Shoes and an Allmight Wristwatch.
I apologize for being startled there at the end. My cat came in through the window and scared me. She's a brat. And she's behind me. I'm talking shit. No, don't leave me, baby. Why are you wet? It's not raining. Anyways, thank you for watching. I remember to eat something healthy and drink some water or something. I don't really care what you drink, but make sure it's water adjacent. Also, remember caffeine just coffee just dehydrates you faster. So, just drink water, bro. Remember to sleep. Yep. Gute Nacht.